This map of Asia, printed in England in 1746, reveals the perception of the Indian subcontinent in that period. Approximately the area that we now recognize as the nation state of India is described here as India within the Ganges. The region east of the river Ganga, including Myanmar, Malaysia, Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, and Vietnam, is called India beyond the Ganges. The Indonesian archipelago is called East Indies, reflecting the Indian influence on that area also. For over 2000 years, India within the Ganges has had a profound influence on India beyond the Ganges, if I am permitted to use that terminology just for this context. History is always written by conquerors. But even 60 years after India became a free democratic republic, our history books are chained by colonial colored glasses. Breaking away from this, we are launching on this pilgrimage. We retrace ancient voyages in this devotional sojourn, worshipping the gods and avatars of the Hindu pantheon in Indonesia, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam. Don't be surprised that this is another sacred river for the Hindus, although it does not flow anywhere through India. This river flows from the Tibetan Himalayas through territories in China, Myanmar, Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam before reaching the South China Sea. This majestic beauty is the lifeline of these lands. The early Indian migrants to Southeast Asia, several centuries before Christ, considered this a manifestation of their holy Ganges, and hence reverentially called her Ma Ganga, a name which became Mekong in local accent over the centuries. More of this river flows through Laos than through any other Southeast Asian country. Here we are on the banks of Mekong, or should I say Ma Ganga to revive an old name, at Champasak in Laos. As we sail in our little boat in the wide, tempestuous and majestic Mekong at Champasak, we are introduced to a holy mountain not far from the river banks. This is Linga Parvata, a hill range worshipped by the local people from time immemorial. As the name indicates, it is the abode of a Shiva Lingam, and a Shiva temple has existed here from about the 4th century when it was called Sreshtapura, a name meaning a glorious city. On the foothills of Linga Parvata, we begin to explore Wat Phu, a World Heritage Monument as declared by UNESCO. Shiva and Parvati, mounted on a Nandi, give us darshan even as we approach the ground level pavilions. Thank you.
The Wat Phu Shiva Temple is spread over many acres in different levels. And as we climb to a middle level on the hills, we discover an ingenious aspect of the planning. We pray to a five-faced Shiva Panchaka, a four-faced Brahma, as well as a Vishnu, placed in such a manner that they used to get a water stream falling on them in a perennial Abhishekam. Here we are facing the main shrine at the hilltop, a 11th century construction as a Shiva temple, converted a few centuries later as a temple for the Buddha. The bas reliefs here narrate mythology to you. Here is Hanuman fighting some asuras during the Ramayana war in Sri Lanka. Elsewhere, there is Krishna performing his Kalinga Nardhanam and Indra riding his three-headed Airavata elephant. We worship the Buddha in silence and peep behind him only to see a hidden old sanctum sanctorum which used to house the large Shivalingam. We have a darshan of the broken lingam and its yoni pedestal in the Wat Phu Museum nearby. At the Wat Phu Museum, there are indeed several sacred icons of Nandi for one and a Garuda carrying Vishnu on his shoulders among other idols. These are recovered from the ruins of Wat Phu. And a stone Nataraja in the museum, which takes us to a grand Hindu connection with the performing arts of Laos. Nataraja is worshipped as God Panalai in Laos, and he is the presiding deity of performing arts. The dance dramas are often adaptations of Palak Palan, which is the Laos version of Ramayana. Like everywhere else in Southeast Asia, people follow Buddhism with strong Hindu undercurrents. We bow our heads to the Buddha at the most sacred place of worship for the Lao Buddhists, Pa Thart Luang. Although this stupa as it stands now is about 400 years old, it is on a location where a relic of the Buddha was brought and enshrined by Emperor Ashoka's messengers three centuries before Christ. The museums of Laos in the capital Vientiane and in Luang Prabang as well as in Pak Se are full of sculptures of Vishnu, Ganesha and Shiva brought from ancient Hindu temples which flourished all over the area at one time. From Sreshtapura, which King Devanika established at the foothills of Linga Parvata in Laos, we fly across to Bangkok, one of the most modern cities of Asia today. If you have been in the Thai capital, as Bangkok is a very popular tourist destination, you would have surely visited the Royal Palace. Who would miss the Temple of the Emerald Buddha in this magnificent palace? Visitors from all corners of the world, more so from India, would surely not miss to walk around the corridors here, which carry paintings based on the Thai version of Ramayana. However, what tourists from anywhere, including India, normally miss to visit is an open-to-sky temple immensely popular among Thai devotees. Right in the middle of a busy junction is Eravan, a word derived from the Tamil Iraivan, meaning God. Here we are at the temple for Brahma. You may know that in the Hindu tradition in India, the only temple for Brahma is at Pushkar in Rajasthan. But cutting across religious barriers, Brahma is worshipped all over Thailand. At Yerevan, it is common to take a vow that you would organize a dance worship for the deity on your behalf. Groups of dancers and musicians are always available for this. We too join the devotees here and organize a dance recital on our behalf as our prayer to Brahma. Brahma is worshipped as a Parivara Devata at this Pnom Rung Buddhist temple in the ancient city of Ayodhya. Ayodhya, named after Rama's capital, was the capital of Siam. A series of Ramayana bas-reliefs decorate the outer walls of this temple. The capital of Siam was shifted to Bangkok about 200 years ago, and the name of the country changed to Thailand in 1937. Ayodhya has several temples and monasteries of the medieval period. Among the ruins here are many Hindu as well as Buddhist temples. Before it morphed into Siam, the country was known as Dwaravati and its capital was at Lodhburi. We worship the Trimurtis and the Buddha at this Pra Prang Sam Yod. It is evident from the yoni pedestals in the sanctum from which the lingams have been removed that this was originally a temple for Shiva, Vishnu and Brahma. Later, it was converted to a temple for the Buddha. Right across the road from Pra Prang Sam Yod is the small but amazingly active and live Vishnu temple of Sam Prakan. In a small shop of puja articles in the temple compound, the Thai devotees of Vishnu buy paintings and prints of Hindu deities, get them sanctified at the Vishnu temple, and take them home for their personal worship. Hanuman is a favorite god of Thailand. According to the Thai version of Ramayana, Hanuman was flying over Thailand when he carried the Sanjeevani mountain from the Himalayas to Lanka. When we drive about 2 hours from Lodhburi, we get a darshan of Hanuman installed on top of a hillock, which, according to local belief, broke away from Sanjeevani and fell there even as Hanuman was flying above. We return to Bangkok to visit another active Hindu temple which is several centuries old. Popularly known as the Brahmin temple, this temple is headed by the Rajaguru to the King of Thailand. Several religious ceremonies in the royal palace follow Hindu customs, although this is a Buddhist country. The Rajaguru is known as a Buddhist Brahmin. For instance, I have an important role to play at the time of the royal coronation. I lead a chanting of the ancient Tamil hymns of Tirupavai and Tiruvambavai regularly in this temple as well as on all ceremonial occasions at the king's palace. We decide the auspicious dates and time for the functions at the royal palace. My ancestors migrated from the holy city of Chidambaram about 700 years ago and settled down here. I come from a lineage of religious preachers who are appointed by the King of Thailand as Rajaguru over the generations.
Most of the bronzes in this Brahmin temple can be traced back to Sukhothai art. That takes us to the ancient Thai capital of Sukhothai in northern Thailand, a 2-hour flight from Bangkok. We worship many magnificent Buddhas here, and also discover that there were as many Hindu as Buddhist temples in this ancient town. We are in the sacred temple known as Wat Phu, originally built as a temple for Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva nearly 800 years ago. It later served as a Buddhist monastery and is presently only an archaeological monument. In our devotional sojourn, however, we dig through the ethereal layer of such monuments and follow our spiritual quest. Like everywhere else on this pilgrimage, we find spiritually charged pieces of art in the museum. This bronze Harihara is one such. Another masterpiece of the Sukhothai Museum is the Walking Buddha. Historians here reveal that it was made in Thailand, inspired by and modeled after a bronze of a walking Buddha in Nagapattinam in Tamil Nadu about 8 centuries ago. Sukhothai has several gigantic Buddhas, perhaps to help dissolve the ego of the aspirant. We travel a few hundred kilometers to central Thailand and worship the Buddha in this Pimai temple, originally built for Shiva and later converted as a temple for the Buddha. But the Hindu motifs on the tower and all around remain unchanged. And we leave Pimai to travel for a few hours to reach the Shiva temple of Pnom Rung in northeastern Thailand. Pnom Rung is built on the site of an extinct volcano. It has been a sacred site for at least 1500 years since a small place of Hindu worship existed here even in the 6th century. We are most fortunate to enter this holy temple, which is the most important Hindu landmark of Thailand. Since it is a protected monument under the Archaeology Department of Thailand, without any worship, the dancing Nataraja in the lintel of an entrance tower does not quite prepare us for what is in store. We begin to hear a chanting voice from the sanctum and learn that the Archaeology Department permits anyone to worship the Shivalingam in the sanctum with formal puja, although it happens very rarely, perhaps once in a few years. And a truly elevating experience awaits us.
Om Shivami Namrami Tari Vishamriyam Parimintayam Chamaram. Has
your family been worshipping Shiva and Ganesha, your father, your grandfather, everybody in the family, or you took it now?
No one in my family before me were devotees of Shiva. I was an Indian in my previous birth. This time I'm born in Thailand. But my devotion to Shiva continues. Today I felt like coming to this temple and worshipping Shiva. This is not a mere coincidence. I suppose the Lord asked me to choose this day to meet you all. When you are here filming, Shiva wants you to know He is blessing you through me.
Our next destination in the Pilgrim's Progress is Central Vietnam. Cham musicians who sing the glory of 15 centuries of tradition of the ancient kingdom of Champa, now a part of Central Vietnam, welcome us. The Chams are descendants of Indians who settled in Central Vietnam, intermingled and married local girls in the first millennium after Christ. Some of them, like this priest in a temple, do not even know that their religious beliefs have their origins in India. Yes, they worship Shiva in their own ethnic way, as we shall discover soon that they worship many other gods of the Hindu pantheon. After an hour's drive from the city of Da Nang, I am overwhelmed by what I see. Am I dreaming?
As I walk through this timeless corridor of eternity, I am rubbing shoulders with a million pilgrims over 1,000 years, worshipping Lord Shiva. This is Mysong, a World Heritage Center in Central Vietnam.
From the time it was established as a Hindu kingdom in the 4th century by King Bhadravarman, with this place then known as Amaravati as its capital, Champa lasted as a prosperous kingdom for over 1,000 years. The Chams lost their power and sheen in the 16th century, but these places of worship of Shiva, Vishnu, Uma Maheshwari, Lakshmi, Brahma and Saraswati continued to flourish for 3 more centuries. Mysong, as this archaeological site is now called and preserved with pride by the Vietnamese government, spreads over a vast area housing about 70 Hindu temple towers. The kingdom of Champa, which included large chunks of central and south Vietnam of today, had several hundred Hindu temples. Most of them are in ruin today. Records show that some of these temple towers at Mison and the bas-relief stucco figures were once originally covered with gold leaf. Champa had a great maritime trade with India on the west, China on the north, besides the kingdoms of Indonesia in the south. Our pilgrimage would be incomplete without visiting the local museums, the treasure houses of icons of ancient art, profound faith and wisdom. The site museum at Mison, and to a larger extent the National Museum of Champa Arts in the city of Da Nang, compel us to walk through in wonder with pious folded hands. The statuary, which once occupied the sanctums of these hundreds of temples, include several Ganeshas and several Lingams. Besides lingams, Shiva is also seen in his human form. There are also several dancing Shivas. Besides dancing Uma, several Vishnus, many Brahmas, several Lakshmis, singing Saraswatis and dancing Saraswatis. We find Krishna enacting his several pranks. If Shiva has 1,000 hands, why doesn't he give me at least 1,000 eyes to admire his divine dance in stone? We take another look at the Mison site. Imagine these icons in their sanctums in these temples. Several of these temples were in reasonably good shape, and some of them in daily worship as late as the mid-20th century. Can you guess what happened to them?
This crater here tells the atrocious story of American carpet bombing during the Vietnam War. in 1969, suspecting rebel guerrillas to be hiding in these ancient monuments, the American Air Force did a liberal shower of bombs, destroying a majority of the 70 Hindu temples that existed in this part of central Vietnam. Angered and anguished, the internationally reputed art expert from France, Philip Stern, appealed to President Nixon against this atrocity. The president condescended to allow about 20 of these towers to be spared from these bombings and survive. Today, UNESCO has declared this as a World Heritage Monument.
The tallest of the Mison towers, about 75 feet high, was demolished by specially brought in helicopter bombers flying at low level to reduce these priceless legacies of faith to rubble. But the heroic and pious Chams have not been disheartened. They continue their centuries-old worship in the few temples that have survived. We have taken a short flight to the city of Nha Trang. In the outskirts of the city is Po Nagar, a temple which traces its origins to the 4th century as a wooden temple. Rebuilt with bricks about 1,000 years ago, Po Nagar attracts devotees from far and near to worship both Shiva and the presiding deity, Kautareshwari. There are several small shrines for Parivara Devatas, and they are regularly visited by devotees.
We are most fortunate indeed to be among the rarest of rare devotees from India to have the privilege of worshipping here in this live temple. With everyday aradhana for over 1,000 years without a break and hardly known to the outside world.
And then we fold our hands to a dancing Uma on the pediment of the Sanctum Sanctorum before entering and having a darshan of Po Nagar or Kautareshwari, also called Bhagavati. Jata Veda Se Sunava Maso Mamarati Yato Nidaha Divedaha Sanaf Parishadati Durga Nivishwana Veva Sindhum Duritat Yagnihi Tam Agni Varnam Tapasa Jvalanti. We travel a few hours further south from Nha Trang to the city of Pnom Rung, a name derived from the original name Panduranga, as it was called until a few centuries ago. We are at the Shiva temple of Po Klang Garai on a hillock to participate in a festival here. Hundreds of devotees have arrived here from nearby villages to make their offerings to the Lord. They wait for the puja to be over in the sanctum. Then all their offerings are deemed sanctified and they consume them as prasad. A dancing Shiva on the lintel of the sanctum welcomes us. We are grateful to the Cham priests for allowing us to film their worship in the sanctum, although our lights were prohibited and the images are grainy. Along with them, we worship a Mukhalingam. When other devotees have left, the priests, who call themselves Cham Brahmins, have their prasad in front of the main tower. In the second part of a different pilgrimage, we will be visiting Indonesia, including several sites in Java and Bali. And in the third and concluding part, we will tour captivating Cambodia.